Assalamu alaikum and very good afternoon, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. We welcome you to the Distinguished Lecture Series program and brought to you today live by the Faculty of Engineering, University Technology Malaysia, UTM. My name is Muhammad Nasir Tamin and I'm with the Department of Applied Mechanics and Design, School of Mechanical Engineering, UTM, and I'm your host for this distinguished lecture today. The Distinguished Lecture Series UTM features invited prominent speakers from universities, research institutions, and industries from around the globe. They share their vast knowledge and experience. They present and update their research and development and innovation works in their field of expertise and engage in discussion on relevant issues with the audience. And today, we are very pleased to welcome Professor Dr. Majid Ayatollahi, the Distinguished Professor and Director of the Fatigue and Fracture Research Laboratory, Iran University of Science and Technology in Tehran. Professor Majid will discuss the subject that is very dear to his heart, and in fact, many of us, including myself, on brittle fracture in nanocomposites. I will pass this session now to Professor Dr. Muhammad Rafiq bin Abdul Qadir, the Dean of the Faculty of Engineering, UTM, to give a brief opening address and introduce our distinguished professor. Over to you, Prof. Rafiq.
Thank you, Prof. Nasir Tamin. Assalamu alaikum and hello, welcome everyone. Welcome to our 17th UTM Engineering Distinguished Lecture Series. My name is Muhammad Rafiq and I am the Dean of Engineering, University Technology Malaysia. Today, it is my utmost pleasure to welcome Professor Majid Ayatollahi from Iran University of Science and Technology. A bit about our presenter today, Dr. Majid Ayatollahi is a distinguished professor and director of Fatigue and Fracture Research Lab in the School of Mechanical Engineering at Iran University of Science and Technology, IUST. His main fields of interest are fracture mechanics, as well as experimental and computational solid mechanics. He has published more than 280 fully refereed papers in well-known international ISI journals and more than 300 papers in the proceedings of national and international conferences. His current H index is 52. Professor Ayatollahi is the author of three books published by Springer International in 2016, 2019, and 2020. He is currently a member of the editorial boards for 7 international ISI journals and has served as reviewer for more than 50 international journals. Professor Ayatollahi received several prestigious awards, including the National Distinguished Professor in 2014 from the Iranian Ministry of Science, Research and Technology, which is a highly competitive award in Iran, the National Distinguished Researcher Award from the same ministry in 2017, the National Eminent Professor of the Year in Mechanical Engineering, awarded by the Iranian Society of Mechanical Engineers in 2018, and the National Distinguished Professor, awarded by the Iranian Academy of Science 2020. Professor Ayatollahi also received in 5 consecutive years a prestigious national award from the Iranian Society of Mechanical Engineers for supervising the best thesis in mechanical engineering. He was a member of the University Research Council at IUST for 10 years and is currently the Iran's representative in the Asian Society of Experimental Mechanics. His research lab is now in international research collaboration with several renowned European and East Asian institutions, including UTM in Malaysia. He has presented numerous plenary keynote talks in international conferences and universities. So that is a biography of our speaker. Here now is Professor Majid Ayatollahi from Iran University of Science and Technology to talk about brittle fracture in nanocomposites. Professor Majid Ayatollahi, over to you.
Thank you, Professor Muhammad Rafiq and Professor Nasir Tamin. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. My name is Majid Reza Ayatollahi. I am the Director of Fatigue and Fracture Research Laboratory, which is part of the Center of Excellence in Experimental Solid Mechanics and Dynamics in the School of Mechanical Engineering at Iran University of Science and Technology in Tehran. And the title of my talk is Brittle Fracture in Nanocomposites. I would like to thank Professor Mohammed Rafiq and also Professor Nasir Tamin for inviting me to give this lecture in the series of distinguished lectures in UTM. And I'm quite happy that I'm again in the UTM family, because I have been in collaboration with UTM since 2013, and I have visited UTM for 4 times. The last time was in 2019. Let me start my talk with a short introduction about polymer components. In recent decades, the application of polymer components has been increased significantly. Traditional component, metal components, have been replaced by polymers in many applications. For example, you can see here dental filling. Traditionally, amalgam were used to fill the teeth, but recently people mainly use polymer filling. These are examples of small gears, which classical gears were produced by metallic material, but in recent years, the application of polymer gears have been increased. There are many components in the car which are made by polymers. Also, machine components like bearing, gaskets, and also many applications in biomechanical engineering like prosthesis and so on. The reason for this interest to polymer components is mainly because they are lighter, they are cheaper, and sometimes in environmental conditions, they perform better than metallic components. But there is a drawback for polymeric components. They are not as strong as metals. They can tolerate lower load compared to the metallic components, in particular in the presence of cracks. When we have an initial crack in a polymer component, there would be reduced amount of load bearing capacity. These are some examples of polymer components that have some initial crack. And this picture is, I think, a well-known picture many of us have experienced. Cracks which have been generated on the LCD of cell phones that we use. These are some other examples of polymer structures or components that have some cracks inside it with reduced load-bearing capacity. To overcome this problem, people suggested to reinforce polymer using fibers. But we have different types of fibers. The classical type of fibers are lime fibers, which are used in traditional composite materials. The second type of fiber are short fibers or discontinuous fibers, which are added to the polymer matrix to improve their strength. The third type is particles that have been added to the polymer matrix. The fourth type are fabric, which are used for strengthening the polymers, and there are other types as well. But let's concentrate on the second option, where we have a polymer matrix with some short fibers inside it. These short fibers can be in different scales. If at least one of the dimensions of these short fibers would be in nanoscale, this would be called nanoparticle, and the composite is called nanocomposites. One well-known example of nanocomposites are related to the polymers that are reinforced with carbon nanotubes, single-walled or multi-walled carbon nanotubes. We know that carbon nanotubes have very strong behavior, extraordinary mechanical properties, very large Young's modulus, and also tensile strengths. So if we can disperse properly these carbon nanotubes inside the polymer matrix, they can pass or they share their strengths with the matrix, and that obviously improves the strengths of the nanocomposite. However, it depends on well dispersion of the carbon nanotubes inside the polymer matrix. If we cannot disperse it well, sometimes these carbon nanotubes join together and take shape of agglomeration, which is not good, which I will explain about that a bit later. With this short introduction, I will explain about the importance of the topic, a brief literature review. and I explain about the fracture test and finite element simulation that we perform, and then I will show the result and will finish my talk with some discussion and conclusions. Because I would assume that the audience have a basic knowledge in solid mechanics, let me just give a basic introduction about different modes of fracture. When we have a crack component, the crack component can experience three major modes of deformation. Mode one, in which the crack faces opens without any sliding or opening mode. Mode two, where we have in-plane shear. There is no opening in the crack faces. We have only in-plane shear. And mode three is the case of out-of-plane shear. No opening, but we have sliding, and the sliding is out of the plane of the specimen. Any crack component can be subjected to pure mode one, pure mode two, pure mode three, or a combination of these three modes of deformation. In practical application, normally we have a combination of them, because in practice we have complex loading condition, not very tuned loading condition to be exactly under mode one or mode two or mode three. So it is important to study the fracture behavior of component in the presence of crack when they are subjected to mixed mode loading or a combination of these modes of loading. The major focus of this presentation would be the cases where we have a combination of mode one and mode three. We call it mixed mode one and three, where crack faces experiences both opening and also out of plane shear deformation. When we look at the literature, we can see that there are some research studies on fracture behavior of nanocomposites to study and to explore how would be the effect of adding carbon nanotubes on the fracture behavior of nanocomposites. But almost all of them were related to mode one fracture, the case of simple opening case. The research studies were started from 2006 and continued 2008, and also in recent years, we still have some research, experimental research on mode one fracture behavior of polymer-based nanocomposites. There are some research studies on mode two and mode one interlaminar fracture and the effect of adding carbon nanotubes on interlaminar fracture behavior. But there is almost no research studies for mixed mode one and three. There are some on mixed mode one and two fracture, and almost all of them have been done in my research lab in the last 10 years or last 9 years. But for mixed mode one and three, there is no investigation in the literature about that, but this is an important case of loading and a practical loading condition. So it's important to investigate the effect of carbon nanotube on fracture behavior of polymer-based nanocomposite when they are subjected to mixed mode 1-3 loading condition. And this is the objective of this presentation that I will explain in more detail in the forthcoming slides. If you have a, if you would be interested to have some example of the case of mixed mode 1-3 loading, I can go back to the example that I showed regarding the cracks which are generated on LCD of mobile phone or cell phones. Imagine that we have an initial crack, sometimes due to falling the cell phone or some impact, we have initially a small crack. But when we push the surface of the cell phone, the initial crack due to bending experiences some mode one loading, and also due to pushing the surface, it also experiences mode three. So we can call crack extension in the LCD of the cell phone is mainly due to mixed mode one and three. And you can see that after a while, these cracks gradually extend and extend, and we will have a web of cracks, as you can see in this picture. This was just an example that this type of mode one and three loading condition have good extensive application in real applications. Okay, so the objective is to investigate the fracture behavior of polymer-based nanocomposites when they have a crack and they are subjected to mixed mode 1 and 3 loading, opening and out-of-plane shearing mode of loading. To investigate the fracture behavior, first we had to design a new loading configuration to perform the experiments. This is the set of experimental design that we had. It consists of a two-part fixture and also the specimen inside it, the actual specimen. The specimen is in the shape of single edge notch crack. And when the specimen is put inside the fixture and fixed by using these pins, then by applying load at different loading holes, we can control the combination of opening and out-of-plane shearing load on the test specimen. Let's see that in more detail. This is the fixture and also the specimen inside it. And we have selected a loading hole for applying the load inside the tensile testing machine. There is an angle between the loading direction and the specimen direction called angle alpha. By changing angle alpha, we can produce different combinations of mode 1 and mode 3. For example, if you look at this case, you can see that the load is applied at these loading holes. So the crack, which is in the center of the specimen, experiences only opening. So it is pure mode 1. And then we can change the loading hole, alpha equal to 40 degrees, we add some out-of-plane shear to the deformation of the crack. Again, by increasing the crack angle, we have higher out-of-plane deformation. And in the last loading hole, we try to generate pure mode 3, only out-of-plane shear deformation. But this has to be proved to see that if the specimen is capable of producing all these loading modes, loading conditions or not. To do this, we had to perform some finite element analysis. We simulated the fixture and also the specimen. This is a larger picture of the specimen here. And these are the details of finite element model that we generated to simulate the fixture and the specimen. And we perform finite element simulation by applying the load at different loading holes in the finite element simulation. What we obtained from finite element simulation was the values of stress intensity factors. Those who are familiar with fracture mechanics know that stress intensity factor is an important parameter which defines the stress distribution around the crack tip. For mode one or opening, we have K1, which is related to mode 1 part of the loading. For mode 3 or out of plane, we have K3, which shows the contribution of mode 3 deformation. So we applied the load at different loading holes, and from finite element result, we could prove that when we have applied the load on the first loading hole, where we had alpha equal to 0, K3 was 0. So we had only K1. That means the specimen was subjected to pure mode 1. For the next loading hole, K1 was equal to 4.5 K3, so it is mode 1 dominated. For the third hole, K1 equal to 1.5 K3, still mode 1 dominated. For the fourth hole, we had K3 equal to 2.6 K1, which is mode 3 dominated. And for the fifth hole, finite element result shows that we didn't have any K1, we had only K3, so we could say that the specimen could be subjected to pure mode 3. So the specimen from finite element analysis, we could show that it is capable of producing all range of pure mode 1 to pure mode 3 and intermediate and mixed mode 1-3 loading conditions. So far, so good. The other thing that we obtained from finite element simulation was the relation between the applied load and the value of K1 and K3. These values are later used when we would like to analyze the experimental result that we will have in the forthcoming slides. So we calculated the values of K1 and K3 as well for each loading hole. The next question would be, finite element simulation is not sufficient to make sure that the test configuration is working properly. We have to perform some tests to make sure that the proposed test configuration is suitable. We decided to perform the test first on a brittle polymer card called PMMA. That's mainly because PMMA is a cheap polymer. We can easily produce that. It's better to test the test configuration, to evaluate the test configuration using this PMMA instead of the actual polymer-based nanocomposite, which we will perform the test later. So to verify the capability of the test configuration, we produce some sample, single edge notch sample using PMMA. The samples, which you can see one of them here, were cut from a sheet of 8 millimeter thick. It was cut by laser machine. To generate the crack, we initially used a rotary saw of 0.4 millimeter thickness, and then we sharpened the crack tip by pushing a razor blade inside the initial notch. So we had 5 loading holes. For each loading hole, we prepared 3 samples to check the repeatability of the result as well. So in total, we had 15 specimens prepared in the description that I gave to you right now. This shows the picture of the fixture and also the PMMA sample inside it, which is a transparent material. This is just the case of alpha equal to 65 as a sample. We performed the test on all the cases at different loading holes, and these are typical curves that we obtain from different cases, from pure mode 1, alpha equal to 0, to pure mode 3, alpha equal to 90 degrees. The left-hand side, or the blue one, is for pure mode 1. The green one on the right-hand side is related to pure mode 3. In all cases, we can see there is a linear relation between the force and displacement that allows us to use the concept of linear elastic fracture mechanics and to use the concept of K1 and K3. What we recorded was the fracture curve, and in particular, the fracture load, which is the peak value of force at the fracture point. We recorded all these values, and these values will be used later to analyze the result. One point which is known in literature is related to the path of crack extension under pure mode 1 and under pure mode 3. When we have pure mode 1, imagine that we have this white surface as initial crack, then we apply opening and crack extend just in the same plane of the initial crack. So we have a flat surface. For mode 3, there would be a tilting angle, out of plane tilting angle, for the path of crack extension. So it is expected when we change the loading condition from pure mode 1 toward pure mode 3, this tilting angle starts from 0 toward the maximum value. Let's look at the fractured specimen that we obtained from our test. These are the examples: pure mode 1 test, alpha equal to 40 degrees, 65 degrees, 78 degrees, and 90 degrees, which shows the case of pure mode 3. If you look at the fracture surface in mode 1, it's quite flat. And then by increasing the mode 3 or out-of-plane shear deformation contribution on the loading condition, the tilting angle gradually increases with the maximum tilting angle at mode 3. So that shows a good result in terms of the fracture surface. So that can be considered as the first verification of the test that we perform and having good result on the PMMA. The other thing that we checked was to calculate the fracture toughness of PMMA based on the experiment that we perform. When we have alpha equal to 0, when we have pure mode 1, the critical value of load, fracture load, when is replaced in the finite element simulation, the K1 value, stress intensity value, in fact, shows the fracture toughness. From our test result, we obtained the fracture toughness of 1.72 megapascal square root of meter, which is a reasonable number because based on the previous studies, fracture toughness of PMMA is a figure between 1 and 2 megapascal square root of meter. So this is quite in the range. We also perform some theory, use some theoretical model to compare the experimental result with the theoretical predictions. I didn't include the details of those mathematical derivation here because I know that at 3 p.m. in Malaysia, nobody is interested to go to details of the complicated mathematical derivation. So I just show the result from those curves we obtained from the fracture criterion, which we obtained from maximum tangential stress or MTS criterion and maximum tangential strain energy density criterion. This is the fracture curve. The hollow circles shows the experimental result. You can see that there is good correlation between the theoretical prediction based on MTS criterion and the experimental result. So that can also be considered as some other sort of verification. And on the left-hand side, you can see the change in the tilting angle or angle phi, which I showed in previous slide, and compare that with MTS and MTS-ED criterion. Both criterion suggest just one curve. And again, we have good correlation between the experimental result and theoretical predictions for the fracture angle. It looks the specimen is fine. So let's move on to the actual aim, the main objective of the research, which was to investigate the fracture behavior of carbon nanotube when they are added to epoxy matrix. To prepare the specimen, these are the materials that we use for resin and hardener. We use aralite LY5052 and aradur 5052 for resin epoxy, and these are some physical specifications. And we added nanoparticles as well. Nanoparticles were functionalized multi-wall carbon nanotubes. If we look at the diameter of the carbon nanotube, it is in the scale of nano, something about 10 to 20 nanometer in size. So we can consider it as a nanoparticle. So using these resin epoxy and adding these nanoparticles, we prepared some samples of nanocomposites. We performed the test on pure epoxy and also in nanocomposite. The white or transparent specimen is related to the specimen that we prepared based on pure epoxy. When we add nanoparticles or carbon nanotubes, its color turns into black. So the specimen will include pure epoxy and also nanocomposite with three different percent contents of carbon nanotubes: 0.1%, 0.5%, and 1 weight percent. And for each case, three specimens were prepared, both for epoxy and also for nanocomposite, and also for mixed mode loading. Because we needed a large number of specimens, we just reduced the test for pure mode 1 to pure mode 3, and also one case of mixed mode 1 and 3. So we had three sets of case in terms of mode of loading. Similar to PMMA, we generated a notch length about 10 millimeter, a bit less than 10 millimeter. And then by pushing a razor blade, we sharpened the crack tip. You can see here the magnified feature of crack tip in the nanocomposite, which has been sharpened, as you can see in the picture. These are some details of producing the sample based on the manufacturer recommendation. I don't want to go to the details of that, but in general, adding CNT to the epoxy and using some stirrer to mixing them to them. And also one important stage was sonicating. When we add the carbon nanotube inside the polymer or epoxy matrix, it is important to make sure that the carbon nanotubes are dispersed properly inside the matrix. If you cannot disperse it properly, as I said earlier, we will have some agglomeration, some carbon nanotubes which have been joined together, and this is not good because polymer cannot penetrate inside the agglomeration, so the carbon nanotube, they cannot transfer their extraordinary mechanical properties to its surrounding matrix. So we use sonication. There are different methods for dispersion. One of them is sonication. So using sonication method, we disperse the carbon nanotube inside the matrix, and also we use a spoon to stir the mixture again, and we add hardener. Again, we had some mechanical stirrer. We degas the solution by putting that in a vacuum chamber, and the mixture was ready, the solution was ready. We casted them inside the specimen mold, and after curing that, the specimen were ready. We just created the holes inside the specimen and also generated the crack or the notch inside it. So the specimen were ready. These are two cases of nanocomposite inside the fixture. This left hand side is for pure mold 3 and right hand side is for pure mold 1. And you can see the black specimen inside it. We performed the test. And for each loading, we had three loading holes, pure mode 1, pure mode 3, and also one case of mixed mode, which was mode 3 dominated loading condition. And from each test, we recorded the load displacement curves. The left-hand side picture shows the result obtained from mode 1 test, and the right-hand side for mode 3. And we have, in each case, four different curves, one related to pure epoxy, the other three related to nanocomposite of different carbon nanotube contents, open one, open five, and one weight percent. It is again seen that in all cases, we have a linear relation between the force and displacement. Again, we are allowed to use the concept of linear elastic fracture mechanics to analyze the test result. We recorded the fracture load similar to PMMA, and these are the results that we obtained from all experiments that we perform on pure epoxy and nanocomposites. We have four sets of rows related to pure epoxy and also three cases of nanocomposites. And we have three sets of columns. The first three is related to pure mode 1 fracture test, the next to mixed mode 1 and 3, and the third set is related to pure mode 3. And on the highlighted column, you can see the test result that we obtained from our experiment in terms of fracture load. In the next step, we use this fracture load, and from finite element simulation that we performed earlier, and I explained to you about that, we calculated the corresponding values of K1 and K3 corresponding to the fracture load. For pure mode 1, obviously, we expect to have 0 K3. So the value of K3F fracture load stress intensity factor for mode 3 is 0. And for mode 1, we have these values, which has been shown here. For the right-hand side, we have pure mode 3. So K1F related to mode 1 is 0. We have some values for K3. For middle columns, we had both K1F and K3F. These are the major findings of the result that we obtained from our experiments. And I have summarized all those results in these two pictures, particularly on the top figure, as you can see that. Let me explain in detail this figure, because in the forthcoming slide, we concentrate on this figure. There are three sets of experimental results. Each set is related to one mode of loading. The set 1 is related to pure mode 1. The set 2 is related to mixed mode 1 and 3. And the set 3 is related to mode 3 loading condition. In each set, for example, in the middle one, we have a black bar, which is related to fracture value obtained from pure epoxy. The red one related to the case of nanocomposite with open 1 weight percent. The green bar is related to open 5 weight percent, and the yellow one is related to 1 weight percent. So by moving from left to side, we increase the percent content of carbon nanotube in the nanocomposite. Let's see what's the vertical axis. It is effective fracture toughness, and which is defined as K effective as square root of K1 squared plus K3 squared. The result that I showed in previous slide regarding the stress intensity factor corresponding to fracture load can be put in this equation, and effective stress intensity factor can be calculated, or effective fracture toughness calculated for each case of loading mode and also non-composite case. Bottom figure just shows the level of improvement compared to the pure epoxy. So we don't have any result for pure epoxy. These are the percent improvement compared to pure epoxy, again, in terms of fracture toughness enhancement. Let's see what are the major findings in this top figure. The first finding, which has been written on the left-hand side, is fracture toughness increases with loading mode changing from the tensile type or pure mode 1 to out-of-plane shear or pure mode 3, regardless of the value of carbon nanotube contents. That means when we compare the first set, second set, and third set, we have an increasing trend when we have pure mode 1 toward the pure mode 3. What can be the reason for that? To find a reason for that, we had to do some fractography study. We looked at the fracture surface in SEM instrument, and these are the results. For the top set of pictures, these are the results obtained for pure epoxy. For the bottom is related to the one case of a non-composite with open wide 5 weight percent CNT. When we go from mode 1 toward mode 3, left to right, it is quite obvious that there is an increase on surface roughness. And the reason for this surface roughness can be related to the effect of out-of-plane shear when we add the contribution by mode 3. When we have mode 3, we have larger shear stresses, and shear stresses can result in shear yielding and shear band, and that generates higher surface roughness. And these shear bands obviously dissipate some energy. That means we need higher energy to fracture the specimen when we move on from pure mode 1 toward pure mode 3 due to presence of these shear bands. The same mechanism can be seen for the case of non-composite as well. Again, we have increased fracture roughness when moving from pure mode 1 toward pure mode 3. And the comparison between pure epoxy and also non-composite, in each case, we have higher surface roughness for each case when you compare between pure epoxy and non-composite. So the first reason could be related to adding the effect of shear loading and the generation of shear band, which could dissipate higher energy. The second finding of this figure is in all the loading conditions, fracture toughness increases with increasing multi-wall carbon nanotube contents. Imagine on the second, just look at the second set of results that we have here. As I said, black line is related to pure epoxy. By increasing the percent weight of the carbon nanotube, there is an increase on fracture toughness. This occurs for pure mode 3, mixed mode 1 and 3, and pure mode 1, but with one exception in the yellow line, which I'll explain about that a bit later. So there is an increasing trend in fracture toughness by adding the percent content of the carbon nanotube. So what would be the reason for that? Again, we had to look at the fracture surface. These two pictures shows the case of nanocomposite with 1 weight percent CNT and nanocomposite with open wide weight percent of CNTs. A careful look at the fracture surface shows the carbon nanotubes. Some of them are quite cut, which has been shown by the green arrows in both pictures. And the other one, which has been shown by the yellow arrows, there are some remaining of the carbon nanotubes. That means that carbon nanotubes have been pulled out of the surrounding matrix. Both of these mechanisms dissipate some energy. We need some energy to break carbon nanotube. We need some energy to pull out the carbon nanotube out of the surrounding epoxy matrix. These are called crack bridging mechanisms, similar to what we have in classical composite as well. Again, we have for the carbon nanotubes as well. Both of them dissipate some energy. That means fracture toughness is expected to increase. The fracture resistance would be expected to increase when we add carbon nanotubes and we increase the amount of carbon nanotubes. There is another mechanism which can influence as well, which we call it the crack deviation mechanism. These four pictures show the result related to pure epoxy, nanocomposite with 0.1 weight percent of CNT, 0.5 weight percent, and 1 weight percent. When we move in this direction, again, we see higher surface roughness. What's the reason for this increased surface roughness? One justification can be the presence of carbon nanotube. When we have a crack would like to extend. When it reaches a carbon nanotube, the carbon nanotube is quite strong, so it would rather to change it path to somehow cross the carbon nanotube. That could increase the surface roughness. And these increased surface roughness, again, dissipate some energy, so it is expected, but adding the number of carbon nanotube or percent content of number carbon nanotube, we have increased fracture resistance in nanocomposites. This is a higher magnification of the fracture surface for nanocomposite of 0.5 weight percent and pure epoxy. Again, here you can see larger roughness, higher roughness compared to pure epoxy. So we can say that crack deviation mechanism is also the second mechanism involved for increasing the fracture toughness by adding the carbon nanotubes. Okay, let's move on to the next finding. And we concentrate on the case of pure mode one. In the case of pure mode one, we have an increase on fracture toughness when we add carbon nanotube toward 1 weight percent, 5 weight percent, but for the case of 1 weight percent, there is a slight reduction on fracture toughness. Although we have added the carbon nanotube, but there is a slight reduction. However, in this case, even we have improved properties compared to pure epoxy, but compared to the case of 0.15%, we have a slight decrease. The question is, what could be the reason for that? Again, we had to look at the fracture surfaces. When we increase multi-wall carbon nanotube to nanocomposite higher than 0.5 weight percent, we observe some agglomeration inside. This is the case of 1 weight percent agglomeration inside the fracture surface. You remember earlier I explained about well dispersion of carbon nanotubes to have better performance out of the nanocomposite. When we have too much carbon nanotubes, then there would be some unwanted agglomeration. This agglomeration is not good for nanocomposite because they can join together. They don't allow the surrounding matrix penetrate inside it to have better performance based on the presence of carbon nanotube. In the more critical cases, if you have larger agglomeration, those agglomeration can act as a sort of a stress concentration. That means we should find an optimum percent value of carbon nanotube. It doesn't mean that by increasing carbon nanotube, we get better and better strength and fracture toughness. In the case of pure mode one, we notice that for the situation of 1 weight percent, we don't have better performance, so it might be better to limit the percent content to 0.5%. Let's move on to the last finding from this figure. In both loading conditions of pure mode 3 and dominated mode 3 fracture toughness is enhanced even after 0.5%. You can see the yellow is larger than green one, unlike to the case of pure mode 1. So what would be the reason for this similar cases in pure mode 1 or in the cases where we have mode 3 as well? We look at the fracture surface. For pure mode 1, we have a flat fracture surface. The size of the fracture surface is small, but on the pure mode 3 or mixed mode 1 3, we have larger fracture surface due to the tilting fracture surface that I explained to you earlier. When we have higher fracture surface, this means that crack crosses larger number of carbon nanotubes till its final fracture. So although we might have some agglomeration, but this increased fracture surface area overcome that effect. So still we have larger fracture toughness when we have pure mode 3 or mode 3 loading condition. That was the reason that we could find for enhanced fracture toughness, even for the case of one weight percent of carbon nanotubes. Okay, let me conclude my talk. In the research study that I presented to you, we propose a new test configuration in order to investigate mixed mode 1-3 fracture behavior in brittle materials. We evaluated the performance of the proposed configuration by performing some finite element simulation and also by conducting a number of fracture tests on a brittle polymer called PMMA. And both cases showed acceptable result for the test that we performed. Then we moved on the main objective, the objective of the research, the effect of out-of-plane shear on the fracture behavior of epoxy-based nanocomposites containing multiple carbon nanotube was explored experimentally. And the finding were the increase in the content of carbon nanotubes could enhance the mode 1 fracture toughness of nanocomposite, but the maximum enhancement for K1 site was obtained for 0.58% of multiple carbon nanotubes. Also in mode 3, and mode 3 dominated loading conditions, the nanocomposite fracture resistance increased with enhancing the multiple carbon nanotube contents. However, this trend was continuous even up to the filler amount of 1 weight percent. The mechanism involved in the observed fracture behavior of nanocomposite were investigated using a scanning electron microscopy instrument in details, and the finding was that crack bridging and crack deviation were the major two effective mechanisms for enhancing the nanocomposite fracture resistance subjected to out-of-plane shear. The topic that I explained to you was just one of the branches that we are investigating in our research lab under the title of fracture behavior of brittle materials, in particular the nanocomposites. Out of the result that we obtained in this branch, I have published two books in Springer International in 2016 and 2019. The first book titled Characterization of Carbon Nanotube-Based Composite Under Consideration of Defects, and the second one, Nanomaterials for Advanced Biological Applications. I am the author, and my co-author is Dr. Munis Rahman Dost. She is a graduate of UTM as well. Also, we have published a large number of articles in well-known journals on this subject. These are just some samples published in Physical Mesomechanics, Engineering Fracture Mechanics, Theoretical and Applied Fracture Mechanics, Polymer Testing, International Journal of Damage Mechanics, and European Journal of Mechanics, A Solids, which most of them are Q1 journals. Okay, before I finish my talk, I would like first express my thanks to my collaborator, Dr. Behnam Saburi, my former PhD student, which these results were mainly from his PhD thesis. And before I finish, I would like to invite you to visit Iran. Different cities, for example, you can visit Isfahan, its beautiful mosques, its bazaar and carpet shops, or you can visit beautiful mosque in Shiraz. This is the picture of Nasirul Mulk Mosque, pink mosque. And also you can visit Yazd, another city in Iran with its desert architecture, unique desert architecture that you can see two sample pictures here. I would like to invite you to visit Iran. As Professor Nasir Tamin and Dr. Yazid Yahya have come, I'm sure they have enjoyed visiting Iran. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Majid. While we digest the overwhelming technical content delivered through your talk, we now open the session for question and constructive comments. If the audience have any question, you may type it and deliver it to us now. Let me start the ball rolling with a simple, you know, a little bit general question related to carbon nanotubes and also the composites. Yeah? We know that carbon is electrically conductive. Okay? If we consider an application, let's say the cover of the handphone, would it be possible to actually align preferably the carbon nanotube so that it forms the desired circuitry? If we can do that now, then the backing of that handphone could also serve as the wiring board itself. There have been some ideas, some talk about that from the microelectronic people. Would that be feasible, you think, to have a preferred alignment of the carbon nanotube?
Yeah, that's a very good question. You're right. In the method that we use, we just randomly distributed the carbon nanotubes. So they to do some strengthening. But if we have some application which the component tolerate the load in one direction mainly, it would be quite useful to align carbon nanotubes in certain direction. There have been some research in research years trying to find some technical method to align carbon nanotubes in specific direction, for example, by putting them in some magnetic field and so on. Obviously, the use of carbon nanotubes is still in mainly in the research stage. By improving the technical ability to produce them, sooner or later we can easily add carbon nanotubes, and we can also align it, as you suggested, to have better properties out of adding carbon nanotube to the polymer matrix.
Okay, great. Okay, we have a question from Dr. Mazdan Johar. The question is, what is the common method used to mix epoxy resin with carbon nanotube?
Okay. In one of the slides, I showed the details of procedure to mix them together. I didn't go to the detail, but the slides are available. Those who are interested can follow that based on the recommendation by the manufacturer. But the major stage is just adding the carbon nanotubes to the epoxy and then mixing them and then using sonication to disperse them, and again some additional mechanical stirrer to make sure that they have been dispersed properly, and also putting them in a vacuum chamber, because sometimes there are some bubbles traps inside the solution. By putting that inside the vacuum chamber, we can degas that. Sometimes we can use some facilities to burst those small bubbles, and then after some curing stage, the specimen could be ready. So the details can be found in one of the slides that I showed to you. Let me bring it right here. Oh, This is slide. This gives the details of preparation based on the initial materials that we had. If you have any further detailed question, I would be welcome to explain about that.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Majid. Any more question coming? Well, I have many in my list.
Okay, right? Good.
Since there, I didn't see any question coming yet. Let me ask a question from computational, from finite element.
Yeah.
We do finite element simulation, and we do finite element simulation now at different length scale. We can do it at the macro scale, then the meso scale, and going down to micro, then nano. So my question is, when we do finite element, the property that we put to define the behavior of this material almost often obtain at the macro level because we are testing physically. And therefore, how small can the element be before the finite element method itself breaks down?
Okay.
Because we are using properties at macro level. If we want to go and have the element so tiny and try to model at nanoscale, because our particles reinforcement is at the nano level.
Yeah, exactly. Another very good question that you asked me. It depends on the objective of finite element simulation. Sometimes the objective is to investigate the properties of nanocomposite at nanoscale. Then we have to have some cell, volume cell, to simulate in nanoscale, and then to relate that to higher level, for example, microscale, and to relate that to a macroscale. That is another route which we didn't follow in the investigation that we had. We just limited ourselves on the macroscale. And the objective, as I explained in the slide that I explained about the finite element simulation, we had two objectives. The first objective, to make sure that the fixture that we have designed, regardless of the material which is inside the fixtures, whether it is PMMA, whether it is carbon nanotubes, or any other brittle material, to make sure that the fixture and the specimen that we have designed is able to produce pure mode 1, pure mode 3, and mixed mode from mixed mode 1, 3 in different cases. So this could be found from the values of stress intensity factor, which we obtained from finite element simulation. And the second objective was to find a relation between the applied load and the stress intensity factors. As you remember, we used those value of stress intensity factor in the later slide to show the result in terms of some figures. So the objective of finite element simulation in our research was only in that level, but there are some other subjects which investigate the material properties at nanoscale, at microscale, and macroscale, which is a multi-scale problem, which is often quite complicated when we want to correlate between the nanoscale to microscale or microscale to macroscale. So we didn't try to investigate the fracture behavior of nanocomposite in the nanoscale.
Okay, perhaps a very quick question, because we are towards the end of the time here. We have from Professor Ahmad Kamal Arifin from UKM, and related to finite element, how do you treat finite element analysis, bulk analysis, or macro scale?
Yeah, I think at the end of your question, I explained about that. We just perform some bulk analysis because we didn't intend to go to the micro or nano scale to simulate the behavior. This is another route which is normally performed in just some volume cell to simulate that. So the objective of finite element analysis was only on the macro scale because we needed the result for that level only.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Prof. So we reach the end of our program today. We thank all of you for joining our program. And the recorded videos of today's program will be made available from our Faculty of Engineering Facebook page. And do share and like them. So we look forward to meet you in our next distinguished lecture series. And finally, I would like to pass this session again to Professor Dr. Muhammad Rafiq for the closing remark. And over to you, Professor Rafiq.
Thank you, Prof. Nasir. And to Prof. Majid Ayatollahi, thank you so very much for accepting our invitation to give a lecture at our distinguished lecture series. It is certainly an honor to have you in our program, and we hope that our collaboration between UTM and Iran Institute of Science and Technology can continue well into the future. And to all of you watching this program all around the globe, thank you so very much. Do like, share, and comment our Facebook, this video, viral this video, and then ask your colleagues and friends to join in our next distinguished lecture series. So until next time, bye for now.
Thank you very much. Thank you.